ఓం శ్రీ గురుభ్యో నమః. ఓం శృతి స్మృతి పురాణానామాలయం పాదశంకరం లోకశంకరం క్షాంతన్న క్షమయా గృహోచిత సుఖం త్యక్తం న సంతోషతః శోభో దుస్సహ శీత వాత తపన క్లేశః ఇజ్ ఇట్ సోఢా ఆర్ సోఢో? సోఢా. ఇట్ షుడ్ బి సోఢో. సోఢ, ఇఫ్ యు బ్రేక్ ఇట్ ఇట్ బికమ్ సోఢ. తప్తం తపః జాతం విత్తమహర్నిశం నియమిత ప్రాణైర్న శంభోః పదం తత్తత్ కర్మ కృతం యదేవ మునిభిః తైస్తైః ఫలైర్వంచితాః. ది ఎంటైర్ లైన్. యు మే వాంట్ టు బై హార్ట్ దీస్ వర్సెస్. ఇఫ్ యు నో ది మీనింగ్ వెల్, దే గెట్ ఇంప్రింటెడ్ ఇన్ ది మైండ్. క్షాంతన్న క్షమయా గృహోచిత సుఖం త్యక్తన్న సంతోషతః. శోభో దుస్సహ శీత వాత తపన క్లేశో న తప్తం తపః. క్లేశో న తప్త. క్లేశ ఇస్ రాంగ్. క్లేశో, సో ఐ హెర్డ్ సంబడి సేయింగ్ క్లేశ. ఇట్ షుడ్ బి క్లేశో. ఇఫ్ యు బ్రేక్ ఇట్ ఇట్ బికమ్స్ క్లేశ. ధ్యాతం విత్తమహర్నిశం నియమిత ప్రాణైర్న శంభోః పదం. తత్కర్మ కృతం యదేవ మునిభిస్తైస్తైః ఫలైర్వంచితాః. ఇట్స్ ఎ వెరీ ఇంట్రెస్టింగ్ వర్స్. వెరీ కాషియస్లీ యూ హ్యావ్ టు అండర్స్టాండ్ ఇట్. యు సీ, దేర్ ఈజ్ యాక్షన్ కర్మ. ఇట్ కుడ్ బి ఏ వరల్డ్లీ యాక్షన్ ఆర్ సెక్యులర్ యాక్షన్ ఆర్ ఇట్ కుడ్ బి ఏ రిలీజియస్ యాక్ట్ రిచువల్. ఎవ్రీథింగ్ ఈజ్ అన్ యాక్షన్, యు నో. నౌ యాక్షన్ ఈజ్ నాట్ యాజ్ ఇంపార్టెంట్ యాజ్ ద మోటివ్ బిహైండ్ ది యాక్షన్. ఫర్ ఎగ్జాంపుల్, ఇఫ్ యూ ఓపెన్ గీత, లాట్ ఈస్ టాక్డ్ అబౌట్ కర్మ, బట్ నో వేర్ శ్రీకృష్ణ అడ్వైజెస్ యూ టు పెర్ఫార్మ్ ఎ పర్టికులర్ కర్మ. డూ దిస్ యాక్ట్, డూ దానం, ఆర్ డూ పూజ, ఆర్ పెర్ఫార్మ్ దిస్ వే, కండక్ట్ యువర్ సెల్ఫ్ దిస్ వే, లైక్ దట్. హీ డజంట్ స్పెసిఫై ఎనీ పర్టికులర్ యాక్షన్. నో పర్టికులర్ యాక్షన్ ఈజ్ మ్యాండేటెడ్ బై శ్రీకృష్ణ. వెరీ ఇంట్రెస్టింగ్. హీ టాక్స్ దెన్ ఫోర్ వాట్ కైండ్ ఆఫ్ యాక్షన్ హ్యాస్ టు బి పెర్ఫార్మ్డ్. ఇట్ ఈస్ యువర్ చాయిస్, యూ విల్ డిసైడ్ దాట్. హీ టాక్స్ అబౌట్ ద మోటివ్ బిహైండ్ ది యాక్షన్. ఆల్వేస్ the motive behind the action he talks about. Like karmanye vadhikaraste ma phaleshu kadachana. So you are performing an action. Where is your connectedness? Adhikaraha sambandhaha. Adhikara phala, adhikara phala sambandhaha. It is mimamsa, you know. It is the karma mimamsa context. So connectedness. So you are, when you are performing an action, Are you connected to the action per se, or are you connected to the result thereof? Where is your connectedness? Means, where is your heart? Is your heart in the action, or it is in the result thereof? Okay. What kind of action? That is not specified. Whatever may be the action. It could be a worldly action, or it could be a ritual. So, where is your heart? Okay, what is the advice given? The advice is, your heart must be on the act per se, not the result thereof. That is the advice. Now, without going into all those details of karma yoga, what I am trying to say is only this much. Shri Krishna's focus is not so much on the act itself as it is on the motive behind the act. Therefore, you have to understand in Vedanta, it is not the action which is important. Some action or the other is done. As long as it is a legitimate action, that is fine. It should not be an illegitimate action. Okay? That we are not discussing here in Gita context. It is a righteous action, that is fine. But it is not about the action itself. The motive behind the action is supremely important. So, that is how the Gita message comes out very strong. A very similar description you find in this verse. Like, very first sentence, kshantam. We do endure quite a few things. Most uncomfortable situations also, we endure. Like, you are hungry. This happens all the time to people who travel. We are hungry. And so, suppose I go to a hotel for some food. And then, so there you have to stand in a queue. I mean, it happens like that. I don't know. You must be able to imagine. So, you please wait here, you will be seated. Like that a board will be there. So you will be standing there. And a young lady will come and make you sit. She will show you where to sit. Unless she comes and shows you where to sit, you cannot sit. You have to stand there all day. And you are hungry. And she is busy. And then you cannot wait any longer. And therefore you give a signal. She becomes a little annoyed. She doesn't show all that annoyance right away on the face. She will be slightly annoyed because you need not signal her. She has noticed that you have come and you are standing. She has noticed. And she will come in her time, not according to your demand. So you are unable to wait with patience. Therefore, she is annoyed. So she won't show the annoyance right away. She will say, like that, she will nod her head. And you go on standing there. And then in her sweet time, she comes. Hello sir, how are you? Like that she comes. She doesn't mean all that. But anyway, she comes. And then she takes you to a seat. And there you may please sit here. And you will be sitting there. Only sitting only. And people will be coming and serving all around you. But you are not looked at. Nobody comes near you. Then again you are impatient, but you should have patience. And then in his time, a guy will come, a suit and boot guy will come. He will be wearing some of the best dress, you know, as if an IAS officer, he comes. And he has a pad and a pen. Sir, what do you like to eat like that, he asks. And so now you give a few things and he notes down and he disappears. And you sit there. And some food will arrive much later. All this you endure, right? All this you endure. How do you endure? With a lot of irritation and annoyance you endure, right? Okay? Endurance is a noble virtue. But there is a rival. Only when you endure with love and enthusiasm. Not when you endure with a lot of irritation and annoyance. Therefore, now you have endured, but you did not gain anything out of it. Because you have endured with a sense of loss, with a sense of frustration you have endured. You have not endured with any love. On the other hand, suppose a devotee keeps fast on Ekadashi day. He goes without food. Everybody around him, like today is Shivaratri, quite a few people keep fast. Many people who don't keep fast, they will be eating 2 times, 3 times, 4 times a variety of things they will be eating. And this guy will be watching them eating. And he doesn't feel unhappy. He doesn't get frustrated. He is quite happy and he endures happily. And therefore, that becomes a noble virtue. When you endure with endure happily, peacefully, lovingly, it becomes a noble virtue. When you endure, the same endurance, you have to endure a difficult situation, you know, the same kind of difficult situation. You see, you do endure, but you are forced to endure and you don't like it at all, then your endurance has no value. Understood? So, kshantam, endured by me, but not due to the sense of accommodation. Na kshamaya. Kshama is accommodation, with a sense of accommodation. So, this I have to endure. It is my duty to endure. Like that I did not endure. Or kshama could be forgiveness. Suppose the other person gives a trouble to you, you endure it by forgiving him. I forgive him. He is giving trouble to me, yet I forgive him. May God bless him. The trouble, I endure it. Generally, it is felt that somebody else causes the trouble. Somebody else won't cause. We are responsible for all our troubles. Yeah, somebody else is like a postman. Like the postman brings the message of unhappiness. He is only a messenger. He doesn't make you unhappy. You become unhappy based on your own karma. So that is the general principle, you know. So we are responsible for our fate. Nobody else is responsible. Therefore, I understand all that. So outwardly, it looks as if somebody else is giving me trouble. But the trouble I have to face because of some bad karma in my life, in earlier life or this life, whatever, I understand that. Therefore, I forgive him. I do not grudge that person. I forgive him and I endure the difficulty. That is a noble virtue. Therefore, in my life, there was a lot of endurance, but it is not a virtue. It is all endurance is because of, all endurance was there, it was associated with frustration and unhappiness. That is my lot. That is what he says. Okay? You understood? Kshantam. Yes, I have endured. Nakshamaya. But not with forgiveness, not with accommodation, but endured. Okay? So what is the idea now? What is the idea that you get out of it? The idea is, whenever you are faced with a difficulty, endure it without cursing anybody. And even if somebody else appears to be responsible for your difficulty, you forgive the person, you accommodate the situation, and enthusiastically, lovingly, you endure. That is the message. Okay? Then the next sentence. Guruho chita sukham chattam na santoshataha. Here is a person who is a devotee, and so he takes the vow and gives up all the comforts of family life. That is the person. And here is another person who gives up all the comforts of family life because he happens to be a medical representative traveling all over the place. Okay? So, he will be traveling, he is away from his family and all the comforts of family life, and he is struggling in a train compartment or in a bus or somewhere. Somewhere on the road, he is a wayfarer, and he curses himself, and he curses God or gods, and he curses whosoever comes across his way, and But the fact remains that he gave up all the comforts of the family life. That is not any giving up. There is no glory of tyaga in that kind of giving up. On the other hand, you give up the comforts of family life happily with a sense of contentment. You give up. Then that becomes a virtue. You got it? So he says, this is my lot. I have given up all the comforts of family life, not happily, very grudgingly, with a sense of frustration, cursing everything. Ultimately, giving up is the common element, right? Therefore, you see, if you have to give up is a must, then give up happily. That is the spirit. So when giving up becomes inevitable, why should you give up cursing yourself and cursing others? That adds to the unhappiness, you know. On the other hand, when giving up is the thing to be done, it is in order, you have to give up, then do so happily, enthusiastically. And you congratulate yourself for being able to give up. I have enjoyed so many things enough. Now it is time to give up happily, so give up. There is a virtue in that kind of giving up. So he is bemoaning that it is my lot to give up all comforts with a sense of frustration, grudgingly giving up, not happily. This is how I am. That is how the poet bemoans. That is the second sentence. Coming to the third, you see, I am exposed to inclement weather, cold, very cold, and cold wind, chill is there. And so, I am shivering with the cold, and going through the suffering, klishaha, the affliction of being exposed to the cold, etc. Okay? And I am suffering. And again, I am doing all this because I am forced to do all that. I am pushed into that kind of a situation. Like, for example, I am caught in inclement weather and therefore I am drenched by the rain and I am shivering and the cold is up to the bones. The cold has entered into the system and I am cursing myself and cursing everybody else also. This is one way. Another way is, here is a devotee. He goes to Ganga early morning. He is shivering, but he doesn't care. He is willing to go through the difficulty associated with that inclement weather, and he willingly enters into Ganga. Ganga is 4 degrees centigrade all the time. And if you put your foot, your finger into the Ganga water, the finger goes into Samadhi. And so somebody has to pull you out of Ganga. You cannot climb out of Ganga. Somebody has to pull you out. That's why today morning I was telling her, when the guy enters into waters, stand by two sentinels standing at this side, just pull him out. Because he may not be able to come out himself. He knows that much. But still, he goes into Ganga. And takes the cold bath. Very painful it is. But he undergoes all that trouble. Happily, lovingly he does that. Then it becomes austerity. Tapaha it becomes. Suppose you are traveling and you forgot to carry the umbrella, and suppose you are caught by a rain burst, and you are drenched to the bone, and you are shivering, and you are cursing yourself, then there is no austerity in it. Right? So you see what happened is, one day we were supposed to get food, but food did not come. Then I declared, today is Ekadashi. Then somebody said, no, I don't think so. Shut up. I am not asking you what is Tithi today. I have gone beyond the Tithis. I have gone beyond Desha and Kala. Don't tell me what is Tithi. I am not interested in that. You take what I have said. Today is Ekadashi. Swami, you may not be Ekadashi. Shut up. Today is Ekadashi. So now, once you think that it is Ekadashi, and therefore the food is not there, it is now my fortune, good fortune, that I am keeping fast on Ekadashi. You convert the otherwise unenviable situation, otherwise difficult situation, into an austerity. You can do that. In my life, I could not do any such thing. I have suffered the cold, exposure to inclement weather, you name it, all physical discomforts I have suffered, but could not grab the element of austerity out of all that. Motive, you know, it is the motive. So when you keep fast, when you are forced to skip food, and when you keep fast voluntarily, what is the difference? The first one is going through a difficult time and suffering from a difficult situation. The second one is tapaha. It is a penance or it's an austerity. Suppose you suffer grudgingly, you don't get anything out of it. Suppose you convert the suffering into austerity, that elevates you. So he says, this had been my lot, that so much suffering I had to endure, but finally I have not performed any austerity. That is how my life has gone. Then one more thing. You see, you are supposed to do meditation, right? Meditation is what? Focus the mind on one thing. That is called ekagrata. And to acquire ekagrata, you have to sit in a posture, proper posture, the back upright, and then inhalation, exhalation, inhale slowly, exhale slowly, or watch the inhalation, the exhalation, etc. In doing so, your mind becomes single-pointed. Okay? So, remaining with a single-pointed mind, or maintaining the single-pointedness of the mind for a while, that is called dhyanam. Right? There is so much dhyanam in life, because my mind was all the time single-pointed, focused very perfectly while I was counting the money. This I noticed. Suppose somebody has to give you some money. So suppose somebody has to give you 10,000 rupees and he gives a bundle, 100 rupee note bundle, and it must have 100. And so we count. While counting, the person's mind is perfectly still. Even a yogi cannot accomplish that kind of single-pointedness. Perfect still. That sound he listens, and that moment he focuses, the count he will not miss. Perfectly still. And at the end he says, one note is less. 99. You count if you want. Okay, I'm sorry. He adds another note. So how perfect he is. So I had been like that. I did have single-pointedness of the mind in my life, but that has no value because I was single-pointed towards money, not towards any higher thing. Na shambho padam. See, shambhu. Shambhavati. It is shambhu. The moment the word shambhu comes, you should not imagine a gentleman. That is not a Vedanta student, you know. That is not the way to go about. Shiva. Shiva on Namashivaya. Some gentleman is sitting there, a weird guy, and so you do prostration unto him. That is not Vedanta. That is crass duality, dualism. You know, crass. Whatever. So, therefore, that is not the way students of Vedanta have to visualize. Shambhu, Shambhavati. It is the being. Bhu is being, you know. You see the words? Bhu, being. Bhu, it is the being which is happiness. It is the sata which is ananda. That is the Shambhu. Shambhu. And the padam, that is the pada. Whatever is Shambhu, sadananda, sada ananda, that is the pada. Pada means padyate iti padam. That which has to be gained in life. So that is the goal. So you have to be reached by a human being. What is the goal? The being which is happiness. Shambhureva padam. Shambho padam iti shashti na vivakshita. That shashti is not the point. Like Brahmalokaha. బ్రహ్మణో లోక షష్ఠి అర్ బ్రహ్మైవ లోక సింహో పదం స ఏకో బ్రహ్మణ ఆనంద తైత్రియ షష్ఠీ అవివక్షిత. షష్ఠీ ఇస్ నాట్ ఇంపార్టెంట్, బ్రహ్మణ ఆనంద మనే మీనింగ్ బ్రహ్మైవ ఆనంద. సిమిలర్లీ శంభో పదం మీనింగ్ శంభుదేవ పదం. సో ఐ హవ్ నాట్ కాంటెంప్లేటెడ్ అపాన్ దట్ రియాలిటీ విచ్ ఇస్ ఇన్ మై హార్ట్, విచ్ ఇస్ ది గోల్ ఆఫ్ హ్యూమన్ ఎగ్జిస్టెన్స్. ఐ హవ్ నాట్ కమ్యూన్డ్ విత్ దట్ ఈశ్వర ఇన్ మై హార్ట్. దట్ షుడ్ హ్యావ్ బీన్ ఎ ధ్యానం. ఐ హవ్ నాట్ డన్ దాట్. బట్ whether the mind is single pointed or not, yes, single pointed on what? On money. Therefore single pointedness of the mind is useless when that point is money. The same single pointedness becomes a means of liberation, freedom or moksha when the point is Lord Shiva. So in my life there was so much focusing of the mind, but always on the wrong thing, never on the right thing. This is how I lived. The poet is bemoaning. Tat tat karma krutam. So what all good acts a spiritual person has to perform, I have performed all those good acts. Like what? A spiritual person, he endures. I have done that. He gives up the comforts of family life. I have done that. He takes all the physical discomforts of inclement weather. I have done that. And then he contemplates or meditates with the single pointedness of the mind. I have done that. Everything I have done. Tat tat karma krutam, which a spiritual guy is supposed to do, I have done all that. Yadeva muni bhihi. Muni means a contemplative person. What all actions a contemplative person performs, every one of those actions I too performed. Only difference is, he gains the best outcome of all those actions. He progresses in his path of liberation, whereas I am cheated by this world. So, తైస్తై ఫలై వంచిత. లైక్ ఐ ఆమ్ చీటెడ్ ఆఫ్ ఆల్ దోస్ అవుట్కమ్స్. లైక్ సపోజ్ యు ఎండ్యూర్ హ్యాపీలీ, ఇట్స్ ఎ నోబుల్ వర్చ్యూ. ఐఎమ్ చీటెడ్ ఆఫ్ దట్ నోబుల్ వర్చ్యూ. గివింగ్ అప్ ఫ్యామిలీ కంఫర్ట్స్ ఫర్ ఎ గోల్ హెల్ప్స్ ది పర్సన్ టు గెయిన్ ఫ్రీడమ్. ఐఎమ్ చీటెడ్ ఆఫ్ దట్ ఫ్రీడమ్. సింగిల్ పాయింటెడ్నెస్ ఆఫ్ ది మైండ్ హెల్ప్స్ ది పర్సన్ టు కమ్యూన్ విత్ ది రియాలిటీ. I am cheated of that communion. Therefore, what a rishi, what a contemplative person is doing, I am doing all those things as a samsari. But what he gets, I don't get any of that. You got the verse? Let us say the verse now one time and see whether it makes perfect sense to you even while saying it. క్షాంతన్న క్షమయా గృహోచిత సుఖం త్యక్తన్న సంతోషత. శోభో దుస్సహ శీత వాత తపన క్లేశో న తప్తం తపః. Here you have klesha, means that top line, that O line is missing in the print. Dhyatam vittam harnisham niyamita pranayurna shambho padam. Tat tat karma kratan yadeva munibhistaistaih phalair vanchitaha. You see, people have offered demonetized currency into Ganga. So they don't get any benefit of offering into Ganga now. That's right. Something similar to that way. Then this verse is quite often quoted. I myself used to quote this, the 8th verse. Bhogana bhukta vayameva bhuktaha tapona taptam vayameva taptaha kalo nayato vayameva yataha trishna na jirna vayameva jirnaha. This has to be carefully appreciated. It only means that I have to explain correctly and cautiously I have to explain. That is the idea. The exhortation is so much unto me as it is towards you. You see, I ask you a question. Are you eating the food or the food is eating you? You think about it. So, the fact is, if you know a little science, you can easily appreciate that we don't eat the food eats us. You see, as we go on eating food, so the food, it consumes every single organ that is inside. So like the food we are eating, and the acid is produced in the intestines, in the stomach, in the tummy, acid is produced. And there is a valve at the end of the food pipe, there is a valve. And that valve, it doesn't allow the acid to come up. It only allows the food to go down. And as you go on eating more and more and more and more food, the valve is allowing food to go down, food to go down, food to go down. It doesn't allow acid to come up, acid to come up, acid to come up. After a few years, the valve becomes dysfunctional. Because so much food has passed through that valve, the valve is consumed by the food. It is made dysfunctional by the food. Now acid starts coming up. And once acid comes up, your throat is gone. And then you cannot eat food anymore. Therefore, your eating of the food has made this whole system dysfunctional. It is like you pour petrol, the gasoline into the engine and burn the gasoline and run. And as you are running, the tires wear out, the engine wears out, the entire body of the car wears out. So, the car is not running. The car is made to run. Similarly, this body, as you eat more and more food, it is getting consumed. Then the liver. We in India, we eat so much of carbohydrate. Body doesn't need all that carbohydrate. This is a misfortune. And also the religious people eat more carbohydrate than ordinary people. Because religious people have so many prasadas to be eaten. So, Brahmanya Swam Prasadam, Shiva Prasada, Rudra Prasada, Vishnu Prasada, Ganesh Prasada, another Prasada, Durga Prasada, Kali Prasada, so many Prasada, morning Prasada, afternoon Prasada, evening Prasada. So much Prasada they eat, they become obese and become diabetic and the liver becomes useless. The liver gets consumed. It looks as if the liver is, the liver, the kidney, all these organs, they are processing the food that you are eating. It looks like that. But really speaking, they are processed by the food. Now, you tell me that people drink alcohol. Now, you think and tell me the guy is drinking alcohol or is alcohol drinking the person? Which is the truth? The alcohol is drinking him. And that is... Similarly, you look at the forms, rupa, like sit before what is called an idiot box, that is a TV, and go on watching. So you think you are watching the TV, but watching the TV means what? The eyes are focused on the TV. But it is equally true that it is the other way. Whatever is on the TV screen, it is getting focused on your eyes. Your eyes are focused on the rupa, or rupa is focusing on the eyes. It is equally true. So, as the TV is becoming older and older, your eyes also are losing the eyesight, and therefore you need a pair of glasses earlier than later. Chatvaram, they call it. Why? Chatvarim shat. By the time he turns 40, he needs a pair of glasses. Otherwise, without glasses, he has to read like that. So, I tell you, some of these principles, I am sure you have enough wisdom in you by now to understand what I am saying. People think that I am doing. You are not doing. You are done. So, when you say, I am doing, I am the karta. And Panini's definition, Svatantra Karta. Among the six karakas, karta, the doer is the Svatantra Karaka, independent karaka. And all other five karakas are dependent karakas. That is how Panini defines. That is okay. The sentence construction is like that. But the fact is, I am doing, no, I am done. It is like, I tell you, our life, it is like this. This person, he has to undergo surgery. And then he puts a sign on the dotted line. And then he is taken into the surgical theater on a gurney. And there the anesthesia is administered and surgery is done upon him. And then he is put back in the ICU, in the intensive care unit. And then he comes out of the hospital and says, I have undergone surgery. Did he undergo surgery? Or surgery is done on him, or he undergoes the surgery, which is the truth? He doesn't undergo surgery. Surgery is done on him. He is a helpless mass of flesh and bones, and the surgery is performed on him. Our life is like that. Life is like that. So as you identify with the body, and therefore life, my life means the body's life. In body's life, body has no say. It is the time which brings youth to the body, and it is the time which brings middle age to the body, and then it is the time which brings old age to the body, and finally death to the body. Everything is brought to the body. Body has no say in the matter. Body is the most dependent entity in this creation. How does it become Svatantra Karta? It does not. This is one thing. Then the idea is not to correct your language that I am going, I am coming, so you know from now on you should not say that. That is not the idea. You should not say I am going, you should say I am gone. That is not what I am teaching you. The point is, you think that you are doing things, you are not doing things, things are done unto you. That is the fact of life. I am quite all right with the usages of the terms. That is not the issue. Now, you take a bhoga. Bhoga. You take the example of that engine, that petrol-driven engine, car engine. Now, whether petrol is consuming the engine or whether engine is consuming petrol, outwardly, it looks the engine consumes petrol. But the fact is, as the petrol is going through the engine, it is making the engine worn out, old, and finally dead. Petrol is consuming the engine. Outwardly, engine seems to consume petrol. Similarly, we feel like we are enjoying the pleasures. Now, come on, you are not enjoying the pleasures. The pleasures are enjoying you. Suppose you eat some very rich food. That is what people do. So, the first thing they do is make a wonderful, most modern, well-equipped kitchen. That is the first thing they do. So, tell me, you talk so much of God. We say God, 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 God half a dozen times per day, but we don't have godliness in the heart. You should accept the fact of life. There is no godliness in the heart. There is only greed for food, for comforts, for money. But outwardly we say God, 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 God. all the time. Therefore, so the point is, so the food, your pleasure, you make, put so much emphasis upon the food. So much emphasis. Some food will come, when time comes, some food will come to my way, prarabdha will bring, some food I will eat it. I do not eat it, the body consumes it. And the body survives by consuming food, and one day it will fall, what a big deal. That is not the spirit. I should get the best possible food, served in a very wonderful table, linen colored table, with the most modern cutlery and all that. All rich people's habits we inherit or we imitate. And then we are enjoying a very cozy, comfortable life. So we are not enjoying any bhogas. The bhogas are enjoying us. Because we end as sick bodies, sick people. You see, bhikshaushadham bhujiyatam, Shankara said, kshut vyadhishya chikitsiyatam. Kshut, hunger is a disease, a disorder. It's a metabolic disorder. Because of the metabolism, the hunger happens. And therefore, whenever there is, suppose you get fever, you take some Tylenol tablet, whatever. Similarly, it is hunger is happening, and therefore it is time to take a pill. And what is the pill? Bhiksha is the pill. Bhiksha ushadham bhujiyatam. Generally, you don't consume medicine in large quantities. Medicine is consumed in small quantities. Similarly, bhiksha should be like medicine. Bhiksha ushadham bhujiyatam. Then one Mahatma, who is a good friend of mine, he told, hey Swami, you got the word wrong. Bhiksha ushadham bhujyatam, you got it wrong. I told, okay, correct me please, how? Bhikshancha aushadhancha bhikshacha aushadhancha bhujyatam. Pahale bhiksha karo, that may diabetic pill le khao. First you eat bhiksha, then you take a diabetic pill. So like a laddu, no, I am a very sweet person, I don't need any further sweets. No, Swamiji, have a laddu. I mean, I have a diabetic. No problem, you take an extra pill. Ah, that's a good idea. Come on, put the laddu there. This is how we enjoy. Generally, the bhoga always described in terms of food. It is easy to describe. The same principle applies to other bhogas also. So, we are eating food? No, the food is eating us, eating away. Like a vessel containing acid, the acid eats away the vessel. Like that, as you put more and more food into this vessel, then the organs, they get consumed by this food, and the blood circulation becomes slow, and the veins, etc., become sluggish. And BP increases, liver goes bad, kidneys go bad, and therefore all kinds of problems happen, and people become sick. The point is, they need not. You need not become sick. It is possible to remain healthy much into the old age, almost up to the death. It is possible to remain healthy. It is possible. It is doable. It all depends upon our attitude towards pleasures. You need not all the way avoid pleasures. Some pleasure is always there. It's all right. But you must be in command, not the pleasures. If the pleasures are in command, we are bound to become sick. So, therefore the poet says, we have not enjoyed the bhogas. We ourselves are enjoyed. Vayameva bhuktaha. The sentence construction, bhogana bhuktaha, means bhogas are the object, and I am the subject. I enjoy the pleasure. Karta karma kriya. Enjoy is the kriya. I karta. And bhoga, pleasure is the karma. That is how we take it. But the fact is reverse. I am enjoyed by the bhogas. The pleasures enjoy me. I do not enjoy anything. So, bhogana bhuktaha, vayameva bhuktaha. In the first statement, bhogaha is the karma. Bhogana bhuktaha, karmana prayoga. And in the second statement, we are the karma. Vayameva bhuktaha. Okay? And every sentence, every other three sentences are also constructed on similar lines. So you have to understand that the Sanskrit, the literature part also, the sentence construction also simultaneously. It's an opportunity to learn some Sanskrit. Tapona taptam vayameva taptaha. You are supposed to practice austerities. You are not practicing any austerities. Austerities are practiced upon you. Like what? Suppose you keep fast, you have practiced an austerity. Suppose you are forced to postpone your food, the doctor says don't eat. This is Ayurveda. Don't eat this, don't eat that, don't eat this, don't eat that. So you follow the instructions strictly. At the end of the day, you have not eaten anything. Therefore, now the austerity is practiced upon you. You did not practice any austerity. Okay? I told you, Shivaratri, I wanted to keep fast on Shivaratri, but no, I don't keep fast on Shivaratri. I have to eat food. Then I eat something. It becomes poison. Therefore, for the rest of the day, I won't eat anything. Now, did I keep fast? Or a fast is imposed upon me? So, I am not the karta of the fasting or of the austerity. I am the karma of the austerities. So, tapona taptam vayameva taptaha. Okay? Kalona yataha vayameva yataha. You see, this is another very profound statement. We celebrate 31st December. So, what is there to celebrate on 31st December? Is it any of your accomplishment, 31st December? Like, you caught hold of the year, 2016, by the year, and pulled it and pulled it and pulled it and pulled it and with a lot of difficulty pulled it into 31st December. Oh, I have accomplished. Then you have a right to celebrate. Right? You have pulled the year by year. You got it? Did you pull the year by year? Or the year pulled you by the year? What is happening? So, the time it catches the guy by the hair, by the locks, and pulls him, bara, 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 pulls him. And he now arrives at 31st December and says celebration. What is celebration? This celebratorial attitude is unworthy of students of Vedanta. You are not supposed to celebrate. You are a yogi, right? Yogi tasmat yogi bhavarjuna. Yogi, yoga is a jnanam. Yogi bhavarjuna. You have to become a yogi, an aspirant, a striver. What is yoga? Yoga is this. That is yoga. Not this. So this celebration, etc. is wrong and we should avoid it. You know what I do? It's nothing personal. On 31st, I purchase my ticket of travel. 31st December, I am on the journey. So that this nonsense of celebration, etc., I avoid. Really. Because the celebratorial attitude, it gives you a wrong impression that the world is real. You are supposed to realize that the world is not real. It is unreal. That is what you have to recognize or realize. But now you do everything to prove that the world is real. How are you going to do? Therefore, kalona yataha, time did not go anywhere. Time doesn't go anywhere. Vayameva yataha, we are gone. Trishnana jirna vayameva jirna. You see, jirna means aging. Juru vayohanav, that is the dhatu. Juru or juru, dirgham maybe. So, vayohani means aging. So age comes upon things. Like, you see this book, When it was printed, the pages were white. Now, due to the acidity of the paper is acid in nature, and therefore, the acid which is present in the paper, it eats the paper itself, and therefore, paper loses all its color. It becomes it fades in color, and also, if you touch it without caution, it will break to pieces. So, aging happens to the book, a dead object, like inanimate object, like a book, it gets the effect of time. What to speak of living objects? Therefore, so aging, the process of aging happens. So as we age physically, we should have digested trishna. Digested means you must have processed and got rid of trishna. Trishna is greed. So, initially, people are greedy. Children are very greedy. You see, children, if there are 5 chocolates, the child wants all the 5 chocolates. That's why mother doesn't show the original box of chocolates. She keeps it hidden, secret, and pulls out only 1 chocolate. And child says, no, I want one more, there is no second. Then the child agrees. But if child sees the 2 chocolates, it wants all the 2 chocolates. And if there is another child, the child doesn't want another chocolate to be given to the second child. The second child should not be given the chocolate. And all the chocolates, I alone should be given. This is how the child cries. Right? We are no better. Are we better than that? Did we grow? We have aged, true. But did we grow? We have not grown. We only aged. So, we have aged. Age or time has made us wrecks, physical wrecks. A face which was so shining and very smooth like a mirror and very attractive. And so the poets, a poet can describe the cheeks, etc. A lot of description can be. Tanvi Shyama, if you ask Kalidasa, he will describe in glorious terms. Shikari Dashana, Pakva Bimba Dharoshti, like that. In the most beautiful way he will describe. But age, it will show its horrific effects upon the face. Now, you don't feel like looking at that face again. In Hollywood, some of these stars, they see their face in the mirror and they get disheartened. Am I this person? Then take the album and compare with that photo. Look at that and look at the mirror. No. This is not acceptable. So what to do now? They commit suicide. Marilyn Monroe committed suicide. Why? It is a subject of guesswork. Skin people are guessing. Researchers are guessing. What could be the reason for that committing? So they have not yet come to any conclusion, I suppose. Or you may have to go to Google Guru and find out whether they have reached any conclusion. So, therefore, the age is coming upon us. We are becoming old and decrepit. And eventually we will die. But the greed is very healthy, very strong, and also young, and very powerful, the greed. So the greed is not digested. The greed for the things of the world, the greed for wealth, the greed for position and power, these things are not digested. These things are not processed and digested. Only the body got aged, got into old age. So, trishnana jirna, vayameva jirna. The greed must have been processed and got rid of. That did not happen. We have become very old and now we are ready to die. That is it. All vairagya, you know. You see, the vairagya, the dispassion grows upon the person when he sees the utter uselessness of the worldly things, the That you get attached to the things of the world is a spiritual bankruptcy. And once you see that clearly, you get dispassionate. That's why the poet describes in very dramatic terms these things. Okay? Let us say the verse one time. Bhogana bhukta vayameva bhuktaha. Tapo na taptam vayameva taptaha. Kalo na yato vayameva yataha. Trishna na jirna vayameva jirnaha. Valibhir mukhamakrantam. Palitairankitam shiraha. Gatrani shithilayante. Trishnaika tarunayate. I will do this verse in the evening class. So let us meet at 4:30. And have the class. I have taken permission from Shantatmanandaji for 4:30 class. There is a ritual there. Therefore, after the class is over, you please rush to that program. Okay?